Good day to all of you. I just come rushing back from a program. I spent the whole morning with 400 kids, and you can understand, while mentally I was rejuvenated, physically how tired I was. Anyway, I've rushed back, so if I'm a little breathless, please excuse me. What we are going to talk about today is how we tend to, at times, you know, take life in a very contented manner and think that, yes, everything is going fine, so I don't need to really put in much efforts to think. There's no setback, there's no hurdle, there's no challenge. So we get a little complacent thinking that, yes, everything is going fine. If there is some setback, if there is something required, then I will bring about a change. Otherwise, I'm happy with the way life is going. So why should I even think in terms of any change or any introspection? That's the habit that we sometimes make. Talking about habits, you know that all of us have habits. Sometimes they are very, very simple and small ones. Sometimes they are very elaborate ones. But I don't know if you've ever done this exercise of listing out what are the habits that you do on a continuous or a repetitive basis. Every Sunday I go to some such place and do this and come back. Every time I have to go to this, my office, I take this particular route. I start at this time. Every day I start my day with a hot cup of coffee and a newspaper or whatever it is. Now, nothing wrong with it. Yes, it's good you have that discipline and you have that routine, but what I wanted to caution you is that sometimes, you know, habits actually overwhelm us. We become so used to them, we become so addicted to them, we become so dependent on them that we don't even realize that we are doing only that and nothing else. We are not bringing about any change, and that we are not exploring whether certain things can be done in a different manner. So we stick to our habits, and that at times can lead to some sort of either a burnout or too much of mundane routine, or a feeling that life doesn't offer me any variety and excitement. So we tend to become dull. And that is why I brought out this topic called reinventing yourself. Then whatever you are today and whatever you have achieved, whatever you are doing today, there is always scope to reinvent, to start on a new footing, to do something very different. In fact, since I use the word reinventing, let me also tell you that there have been many, many inventors, right? Scientists or various people who have invented new things. They have one thing common in them, regardless of which field they did their inventions in. One thing which is common to them is that they, from time to time, start visualizing the unknown, visualizing something which is not visible to others, or which people don't even know about that such a thing can, exist. Many a time I have seen, people who have visualized, like one of the classic examples of that is Walt Disney. Walt Disney one day visualized, had a dream that there can be something called a Disneyland, a fantasy park, a giant fantasy park, costing millions or maybe billions of dollars, where every possible activity, every possible game, every possible ride can be given within one campus. He went about trying to get people to back up his project and to finance it. They literally laughed at him. They said, projects are meant to be business projects. They are supposed to offer certain products or services which get money. These rides and these and whatever you are talking about is okay for small children to just enjoy. You have some carnival, you have something. You can't make it into a giant corporate project and earn money and pay our interest and make profits. They didn't back him up for a long time. He didn't give up hope. because he had that thing of, you know, that I need to reinvent and create something new. Finally, when he got his finances and the project started off, before the project was completed and inaugurated, Walt Disney died. There was a VIP who had been invited, you know, to inaugurate it. And he saw the place and he praised it very highly. And he said, such a great thing has built up and this is going to be very revolutionary and all that. And then he said, it is so sad that today Walt Disney is not alive to see this. One of Walt Disney's very close friends was sitting next to him. He very politely told the chief guest, sir, you're mistaken. Walt Disney has already seen this place. In his mind's eye, he has visualized it. He knew exactly how and what it is going to be. And because Walt Disney could visualize, that is why we are seeing it in real form now. These are the type of people. Walt Disney was a very excellent cartoonist. He brought out this, you know, Mickey Mouse and Donald Duck and all that. Initially, he had a lot of problems, but subsequently, he had become a very accepted, very popular, and a very successful cartoonist. Normally, a person like that would rest on his laurels, keep making new Mickey Mouse cartoons and making more money and doing whatever it is, isn't it? He reinvented himself in the form of Disneyland. And the interesting thing I wanted to share with you is, because he did that, no, the whole atmosphere, I'm told, the whole thinking of people who work in Disneyland became very, very out of the box and very inventing type. They realized that there are people who are designers, who design new rides. So every time they wanted to, you know, keep updated and to attract more people, they kept adding more and more and different types of rides in Disneyland. Now they would ask the design team to design something. They would design. It would look beautiful on paper. Everybody would appreciate and all that. And then the drawings would be handed over to the engineers who have to actually build that structure, that ride, the motors, the these, whatever has to be done. And in many cases, the engineers, the technical people who are supposed to be building that, started protesting. This is not viable. The center of gravity is too high. The air resistance is very much here. The fuel consumption will be like this. There that this thing may topple over. They kept on coming out with excuses. So you know what somebody did? How he reinvented the whole thing? They went to some of the really reputed universities which were producing engineers. And in that, they recruited engineers who were very good with design and creativity. Qualification-wise, they are engineers, but their mindset is out of the box, design, creativity. What they did was that they made a team of these people and asked them to design a new ride. When that team designed a new ride, they transferred them to the manufacturing facility and they said, now you build this ride which you have designed. Now they can't, you know, criticize their own design. So even if there were lapses, they would overcome, they would struggle, they would do something and they would make sure it is successful. And those people, I'm told, have been given this label called Imagineers. Engineers and imagination combined, they are Imagineers. This is just one example. Now, to be able to do that, you have to get out of your comfort zone. You may be successful, you may be happy, you may be contented, but you still have to get out of your comfort zone. And once you get out of your comfort zone, there is no guarantee that you will do well. You're going into uncharted territory, you're taking a big risk, but nobody is giving you that assurance or guarantee that this is what it is. At a very, very humble scale, Walt Disney was a very great man. I spoke to my own friends, colleagues in Banjara, a part of our team, who have, you know, done something very different from what they were doing earlier. So in a way, they have reinvented themselves. I asked them, would you like to share on this platform? What did you do in terms of reinventing yourself? So two, three of them came out with very candid comments, and we have recorded that. And here is Anis showing you that quick little video.
First, I was a housewife and I decided now it's time to move on. What was that I needed to do? I needed to reinvent myself. So then I asked myself, what is it that I want? What is it that I want to change in myself? What career am I looking at, or whether I want to be at home? That's when I started jotting out points, understanding. So then I realized that once I decided that I want to change my career path, I decided what I want to do, and I upskilled there. I studied those courses, and today I am doing what I am doing. Now that in turn built positive thoughts and positive emotions and positive actions and habits. Because what happens is, if you do not have positive thoughts and actions or habits, you cannot reinvent yourself. So it takes a lot to keep coming out of your comfort zone and reinventing yourself. And that is what I did by understanding myself and my surroundings.
Reaching out to people and being among the people was one of something which I always wanted and I always looked for. When I selected army as my career, in the initial periods of my service, I really relished, enjoyed being with the people. But as you climb up the ladder, become a senior officer, the touch with the people was reducing. And that's when I made a tough decision of leaving my uniform, which was, of course, I was enjoying, but I had to leave it. And I got into the corporate. The same thing happened here also. As the time passed by, the way I came up the ladder, again, the touch was lost. Though from being a very comfort zone of a very high salary package, it was a very tough decision, but then I said, no, this is not the place where I belong to. And I stepped out and I came to do the, luckily I came to the way of Banjara Academy. I did this course and now I'm really enjoying this new life.
So as I grew up, I used to see one LGBT community person near my house. I grew up watching them actually. And I never understood how their life is till I actually came into counseling field from the corporate life. So once I started understanding the community with a lot of counseling, with a lot of reading, with a lot of interactions and things like that, I also reinterred myself, I would say, or in terms of as a human, you know, because I started looking at the human aspects in them as well. So doing a lot of workshops, interacting with them, the community people especially, hearing to their stories, you know, what all struggles they have undergone differently from the so-called, you know, heterosexuals. All these things have added a lot of value to my life. And I would like to say that I'm still reinventing on a regular basis, because the learning is never ending.
Yes, you heard three of our Banjarites, so many more. And I always enjoy and I always interact and I always learn something from those who have reinvented themselves. So what did they do? What are the ways and means to do it? Before I take you through the steps of how you can reinvent yourself, let me give you a few quick understandings or tips or whatever that. The first thing is what Meera also mentioned just now, that you have to get out of your comfort zone. Are you willing to get out of the comfort zone? The second thing is that you had old ambitions which you had suppressed. Are you willing to give them birth again? Without saying that I am too old, it is too late, etc. The third is that we get into this presumption that I can't learn new things. It's very difficult. I'm so used to this. I'm so used to that. If you get into that syndrome that I cannot learn new things, then what happens is that we feel reticent or shy to try it out. And when we don't try it out, the fear of failure increases further. And we reinforce to ourselves that, see, nothing is happening. I'm not able to do something new. We forget that we are not even trying it out. So you have to try, you have to make that effort of getting out of your comfort zone. I remember a very, very, stalwart gentleman Mr. Mishra. He was the excise commissioner of the great Uttar Pradesh state in those good old days. Very courageous, very brave man who stood against corruption and this and that. And of course, he paid the price for it. I used to correspond with him. One of his favorite slogans was in Hindi, Girte hain sheh sawar maidane jang mein. Girte hain sheh sawar maidane jang mein. That means in the, at the time of war, those who are riding on a horse or an elephant or whatever it is, those who are the, you know, on top of the thing, they are the ones who fall because they are hit by enemies. To girte hain sheh sawar maidane jang mein, wo kya khaak girenge jo ghutnon ke bal chalte hain. Those who crawl on the ground, where is the scope of their falling down? They're already on the ground. These were the type of people. I have so many such mentors and so many such old friends, you know, the good old days, who have taught me these basic lessons. And that is what has made me think outside the box to get into all these things. If you are stuck, for example, you know, if you find there is no alternative, if you find that no, I will not be able to get out of this problem, I will never be able to succeed, I have failed. When it comes to that, there's another quote which says, move from Tina to Ta. Tina is T-I-N-A. The thinking pattern which says, there is no alternative. Move from that to Ta. There are always alternatives. That's the beauty of life. As long as you are willing to take that risk, as long as you are willing to think outside the box, as long as you are willing to reinvent, there are always alternatives. At the same time, let me also tell you that the best time to bring about a major change in your life and to reinvent yourself is when change is not needed, when everything is going fine. There are no challenges, there are no setbacks, and there are no failures. In those circumstances, I believe strongly, and I've been telling all our students, be for something and not against something. People who are against a job, a relationship, a lifestyle, an economic status, whatever it is, they never reinvent themselves. So instead of being against something, what I exhort you is be for something. I want to do something different. I want to do something new. I want to do something where I know that there is a possibility that I'll succeed. Even a possibility is enough. Because all inventions need out-of-box thinking. And there's another factor to it also. Remember, you have to anticipate change. You have to be willing to take up new roles. People who are stuck in whatever one role, I am a homemaker, I am a mother, I am a software engineer, I am a lawyer. Those are roles that you are playing, right? But they don't define you. That's not your identity. So if you really want to give that, you know, extra spurt and move into something great, you have to understand that you have to change certain definitions, some roles, some activities. People get stuck up. Particularly, I know people who acquire certain designations or positions. They become so attached to it that they find that if I quit this, I will not be able to do anything. But those are the people who succeed. A wonderful example is Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam. He went up the ladder from DRDO to ISRO to scientific missions. He became the scientific advisor to the Prime Minister of India, holding a rank of a cabinet minister and without any limitations on the tenure. As long as the Prime Minister is happy, he can continue in that position. At one point, he had the courage to say, I have advised the Prime Minister on everything that I know. I don't think I have anything to add in order to be an advisor to the Prime Minister. I now want to work with the youth and I want to learn from the youth. He gave up a very cushy position of equivalent to being a cabinet minister in the union government. But because he reinvented himself, he eventually went on to becoming higher than a cabinet minister, higher than even the prime minister. He became the president of India. If he did not reinvent himself, if he did not have that courage to say, just because they are keeping me here, they're paying me a salary, they're giving me the perks and they're giving me everything, doesn't mean that I have to just hang around when I know that I'm not being true to my conscience. The other thing that you need to do is to anticipate change. This is something which I've been constantly telling people, please anticipate change. When you become complacent that everything is going fine, what happens is that you do not start thinking of what are the changes that may come in. And in the same breath, think of what will happen if you do not change. What is the worst case scenario if I bring in the change? What is the worst case scenario if I do not bring in the change? Once you have done these basic parameters and you have, you know, overcome these things, it is time to actually put into action this process of reinventing yourself. And when you do that, here are some very simple tips, 8 points for reinventing yourself. First one is self-awareness. Am I working to full potential? Do I have certain other skills which are unutilized? Have I become repetitive in doing only the same thing and getting stuck and redundant in that? Have I got certain aspirations which are not fulfilled? Am I in some way frustrated about something? So first, do as much of self-awareness as you can. Once you do that, ask yourself, what is it that you need to change? And equally important, what is it that you want to change? There's a lot of difference between the two. I even told you that change when there is no need, because you want to. And of course, change when there is a need, because you have to. So ask yourself, what are the changes that you want to do? Make a list. And then I had already told you, are you willing to come out of your comfort zone? You're already doing something. You are in a profession, or you are a homemaker, or you are this, you are that, whatever it is. And you know that you're comfortable, you've proven yourself, you're doing very well in that. So you have to get out of what we call as the comfort zone. The moment you step out of the comfort zone, you are in a discomfort zone. You have to face new challenges. You have to face hurdles. You may even have to face setbacks. Are you strengthened enough and courageous enough and ready enough to take it up? If you say yes, then please make sure that you are sticking to your principles and values. If you are bringing about a change, if you are looking for something which is a shortcut in order to jump to a better position or jump into something new, if you are climbing over somebody's shoulders, if you are suppressing somebody else, if you are depriving somebody of their rightful needs or wants, that means you're not being true to your principles. Believe me, you never succeed. Even if you succeed in a material sense, you're never happy doing that. If you're clear that, yes, I'm willing to get out of the comfort zone, I am sure that I'm sticking to my principles and values, then set some realistic, short-term and very lofty long-term goals. ST is short-term, LT is long-term. Start with setting some realistic short-term goals and some very lofty long-term goals. To back that up, build positive thoughts and habits. In small, small things, I'm going to give myself a pep up. I'm going to chant some mantras. I'm going to give myself positive affirmations. I'm going to build some positive habits. Let me try out new routes. Let me try out something new. Let me try cooking some different dish, whatever it is. Build these both positive thoughts and positive habits. At the same time, make sure that you have what we call as emotional honesty. See, normally honesty is to do with other people. Am I, you know, truthful in money matters? Do I cheat somebody? Do I keep up to my word or do I let down after making my commitment? That is honesty, which is an interpersonal skill which affects others. There's this thing called emotional honesty, which only affects me. Emotionally, am I honest to myself? When I look at myself in the mirror, can I say, yes, my conscience is clear. I know what I'm doing and I'm willing to pay the price for it. Only if you do that, then you move into the actual doing of whatever you have to do. And whenever you have even a small success, make it a point to celebrate. Make it a point to tell yourself that, yes, I have achieved this very tiny milestone or success. And whether anybody celebrates it with me or not is not important. I'm doing it for myself, right? So I will celebrate these small successes. If you follow these basic steps, then you can add so many more. I keep reminding you, human behavior is not sacrosanct. It doesn't have always some fixed rules and regulations. You can build up anything to do and whatever you want to do. But what is important is to first check out what is the worst case scenario. What is the price that I may have to pay? Who are the people who will support me? Whose help can I get if there is a time of need? If there is a temporary setback or, you know, throwback, do I have people to back me up and to take care of me and to ensure that I don't fall, or even if I fall, they are going to pick me up? So once you do that, you change your cognitive distortions. What I mentioned earlier, fear of failure, no, I may not do this, is it, this is too risky, I'm too old for this. These are all what they refer to in CBT languages, cognitive distortions. Get rid of your cognitive distortions. And very, very important, burn your boats. What do we mean by burn your boats? It comes from an old, you know, medieval times when a king from Africa was being harassed by the Spaniards, the Spain people. They used to come and, you know, conquer and all that. So one day he decided, let me go the reverse way. Let me go into Spain and overthrow them. He built a lot of boats and he took all his army and sailed across the Mediterranean Sea and he reached Spain. The moment he reached there, he told his soldiers, they were all wooden boats, right? He told his soldiers, first burn our boats. They were shocked. Sir, these are our boats. Why should we burn them? He said, because if these boats are here and ready to take you back, the moment there is a negative turn of the war or they get overwhelmingly over you, you will come running back and jump into the boat and sail away. As long as you have that privilege, you will not give it all your best. So he said, burn the boats, and now realize either you have to win the war and conquer the enemy, or you have to die in this process. And that is what they say got them that success, because the soldiers fought absolutely wonderfully. The last point I'd like to tell you before we finish the first half of this thing is, all people who start a new idea, who reinvent themselves, who take up, you know, new activities or whatever they do, they are people who take others along with them. You cannot be successful all by yourself. You have to take others, whoever the others are. There may be just a few core group members, but always remember that you cannot achieve anything in life alone. You have to take others with you. Keeping that in mind, give me a minute's break. Purni is here to update you on what's happening, and then I'll be back.
Good afternoon. How are you all? And Ali rightly mentioned that I will give you a few updates and some nice, very happy news also, okay? Knowing that Ali is a person who will never give information about certain things, I thought I'll take the responsibility of doing that, okay? So, we have this Medical Pastoral Association. It's a healthcare center, halfway home, and they have celebrated their 50th Golden Jubilee celebrations, okay? And for his exemplary work in the area of mental health, Ali has been felicitated by them yesterday. So it is indeed a very proud moment, a very happy moment for all of us, right? For Ali to be felicitated for his exemplary work in the Golden Jubilee celebrations of MPA. You can look it up. It's called Medical Pastoral Association. So that is one. And the other thing is that today also, last, I think, more than a week, Ali, hi Dolly, Ali has been so busy. Our whole team has been actually busy along with Ali doing different programs, going out for so many outdoor sessions. So, and the type of topics, I thought I should tell you because it could be of interest to you. The type of topics which have got covered there were, you know, sexual health, gender identity, selecting the career path, and then selection of subjects. When somebody chooses a career, you know, how to choose the subjects, that was something. Then about healthy relationships, how to have respect for your peers, for your elders, for the teachers. So it has been in various schools that we have gone and done a lot of work, and also the impact of social media. You know, the impact of social media, how it affects our normal day-to-day life. And more so, we have been sharing with you from time to time that after COVID, see, because of COVID, the usage of gadgets became compulsory. And that has now become the norm to use the gadgets extensively. So what is the impact of social media on these children? So yes, Dolly says that she has done her internship at MPA. So that's where it was. So there are so many schools where the programs have been on. And in fact, today, Ali left office at around 8, finished his program, came by around 1:40, caught up a quick bite of lunch. So Ali has become so busy today that today by 1:40 he came, and 2 o'clock he was here for the talk with you. So I think the few minutes of rest is absolutely necessary, and I take that opportunity of being with you all. Hi Pooja, and good afternoon to you. So the other thing that also happens is, see, you must be knowing we have our center counselors at the academy. So we ensure that from time to time, you know, Ali conducts workshops for them at regular intervals to just check, you know, how they're progressing. Do they have any issues, you know, with their counseling sessions or with any particular case, things like that. So when all of us are here, we all get upskilled because of that. So that is another thing which is a news I thought I should share with you. Different workshops coming up, different addresses are going to happen with, you know, the caretakers of special children. So a lot of activity happens on this side of the screen. And whenever you get some time, once again, our unconditional welcome, please drop in. It's an invitation. Please drop in. We can meet up, chat up, and it'll be really nice to see you in person. So over to Ali for all the questions that you will be having. Ali, you have received a lot of congratulations for the MPA.
Oh my, thank you so much.
I shared it with
and
them.
One very interesting thing happened yesterday, other than whatever happened at the MPA, which was very, very nostalgic for me, was that, you know, one of our students who completed DCS more than 20 years back, and I had never seen him or heard anything from him. Of course, you've forgotten his face. And he turned up after that felicitation when the minister left. He came up to me and said, "Hi, Ali." And I'm staring at him. I think I know this guy. And then he told me his name. And I was quite surprised. I said, "Hey, man, where have you been? And you know, what are you doing here, etc." And he said, "You know something? I heard about this event and I came. I was very far away, but I came here only because I saw that this event is happening and I wanted to come here and meet you and congratulate you." I mean, such a small, maybe a small gesture, but so touching. 20 years we have not met, but he still has that sentiment that he, when he came to know that such an event is happening or whatever, you know, felicitation, whatever you want to call it. You know me, I don't go in for anything like that. In fact, I got trapped into this. But more than the thought of being felicitated and all that, there were two things I wanted to quickly share about what happened yesterday before I start off with the interaction. One was that I got an opportunity to meet 10 top stalwarts of the mental health industry in Bangalore, whom I knew 30 years back. Slowly, 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 either they faded out and they were not in circulation or I was not in touch with them. At one go, I could meet all 10 of them, and each one of them has taught me something, has been in some way a mentor or an advisor or a guide to me. And I really felt very happy being there with them yesterday because it was the 50th anniversary of MPA. The other thing I must tell you is we are generally very critical of politicians. Yesterday, I had the privilege of watching, hearing, and observing a minister called Mr. Dinesh Gundurao. He is the Health and Family Welfare Minister of Government of Karnataka. Everything that he did, right from the fact that he turned up exactly on time, he had no airs in his talk. He was very clear. He never praised himself or tried to say anything about his accomplishments. He spoke very well about mental health and what he knows and what he doesn't know about it. And he congratulated me also personally for whatever little work that I may have done. But the way he dealt with that whole situation, hats off. I wish we have more politicians like these. Okay, that was beside the point. Now quickly, let us get down to there. So many comments, questions that have come in. Let's start with which one Anish is going to put up. Smita is again one of our very old students and has been a good friend subsequently also. So true, like they say, aadat jab zarurat ban jaye to badalne ka waqt aa jata hai. When habit becomes a necessity, it is time to change. Yes, please be aware of that. Okay, then we have Madhu. Madhu says, "I too reinvented myself and I'm reinventing. And I'm much, much more happy and doing what I wanted to do. Thank you, Banjara." And thank you, Madhu, for doing what you are doing, because it's an inspiration for us to see all our old students, the way they are evolving and growing. Surekha says, "Self-reinvention is not self-indulgence. It is self-care and self-respect." Absolutely. Let us all be very clear about this differentiation. If I'm doing self-indulgence, if I'm just indulging in myself and pampering myself, no, that is not reinventing. Reinventing is to be very, in fact, strict with yourself, saying that I need to do something really out of the box. Yes, Mamta says, "Good afternoon, Ali. The reinventing journey started since I did the counseling course." Yes, Mamta, that's why we always say that DCS or any of the courses that we do are like seeds which we put in your mind and which germinate years and years later. So reinvention is not some eureka moment that, you know, in 1 minute you have invented something. No, It can be a continuous process, as you know, even Madhu said, continuously reinventing myself. We can keep reinventing ourselves our whole life. Then we have Surekha again saying we have got to be willing to give up who we are now in order to become what we could become. Yes, Surekha, that's why I said comfort zone. I said burn your boats. You should have the courage to give up what you are. You may have been an achiever. You may have made a reputation. You may be having so many positive things. Are you willing to give that up in the process of reinventing yourself? Reena says, I never knew that I could play billiards and snookers very well. It is only when I started it, I can say I reinvented. Yes, many of us, I think we should take this inspiration from Reena. There are sometimes, you know, if somebody says, oh, you have this facility, you can play billiards in this particular player. No, I don't know if I can play. I'll never be able to do it. Unless you try it out, you will never know, isn't it? Reena also says, I have left my comfort zone of Secunderabad and coming all the way to Bangalore to do DCS so that I can improve my quality of life. And you will definitely do it, Reena. I'm very, very confident that you will do it. You have taken a very bold step and we have welcomed you here. And we will make sure that your learning is effective and all your efforts, you know, bear fruit so that you actually reinvent yourself. Smita also says, how does one continue to keep up the motivation to keep going? Sometimes one really wants to get going, but something holds back. How do we overcome that? You remember the last point, I think, which I mentioned in those 8 points is celebrate your success, even the smallest of success. Don't feel hesitant to tell people, you know, I learned to play billiards. I never thought I'd be able to. You know, I'm moving from this one place to another. You know, I'm trying out this. Tell people. Tell yourself. Celebrate those, small successes. I've done only 10% so far, but I have achieved those 10%. Each of these positive affirmations, reinforcements, getting people to acknowledge, go a long way in ensuring that your motivation remains high. Sri Devi says, it's acceptable if others are unaware of our potential, but it's sad if we are unaware of our potential. Very true, Sri Devi. Timely introspection and reinventing is the case. Yes, it doesn't matter if somebody else doesn't praise me, no. But if I'm myself not aware that I can do this and I just languish in mediocrity, it's a tragedy. Then we have Sheila saying, congrats Ali for the NPA felicitation. Thank you very much, Sheila. Kanakavalli, why did you disappear? Yeah, Vali says, as a new student of DCS, I'm on the path of reinventing myself. I'm very happy to be a part of Banjara. Congratulations for the recognition of your service. Thank you so much. Vali, just from people like you, what I get is much more important than getting anything from some celebrities or big shots or whatever. It is. Thank you, Jayashree, for the congratulations. Sridevi says, hearty congratulations. We are driven by your selfless commitment, proud of being a part of Banjara. And I am proud of being part of your team of learners and people who grow and reinvent. Katrona says, congratulations, Ali. I'm so proud of being part of Banjara. That's made a difference in me as a person. Yes. And believe me, since so many of you are congratulating, I was just looking at those great stalwarts. Some of them are, you know, into their 90s and they took the trouble of coming yesterday for the program. 2-3 of them could hardly walk. They had to be supported to come in, from the car into their seat. But the work that they have done, the amazing things that they have done in their life, it's something very, very remarkable. It goes to show that. And these are all unsung heroes, mind you. Nobody has given them great rewards. Nobody has given them some Padma Shri or whatever it is. And they have never made big money in their life. But they can really look back to a life with immense satisfaction. Nagaratna also says, congrats Ali, very happy to be part of Banjara Academy. Yes, Ratna, we are also enjoying having you with us. Sai Prashant says, sometimes reinventing burns our soul. That's a deep thought. Reinventing burns our soul. How to cope with it? That is why, if you remember in the points I also mentioned, what change or what reinvention that I am doing, is it, you know, in congruence with my principles and values? If there's any doubt on that, that is the time when it burns your soul. If you are very clear, true to your conscience, believe me, nothing will happen. Even if you don't succeed in that reinvention, it makes no difference. You'll still enjoy the journey and you will still keep looking for different ways and means to reinvent yourself. Surekha says we need to make vitamin no a part of our mental diet, so that every time we say no, we are moving closer to a deeper yes burning inside of us. Very true. It's a dicey situation. We keep saying no. We try to, you know, hold back. But if you make that, you know, change and you push out. I've got that wonderful video of the eagle, as I had mentioned to you, I think a few weeks back, how the eagle pushes out its eaglets from 1,000 feet high on the cliff, which forces them to, you know, spread out their wings and start flying. That's a reinvention by itself. Padmaja says, I'm experiencing the positive results of DCS. Yes, Padmaja, most welcome. Shobha says, yes, Ali, now I'm searching for the best for me. I don't bother about others are talking about me. Yes, people who gossip, people who say negative things, people, you know, who do this backbiting, they're not worth even thinking about. Keep them away from you. Surekha says, in order to do something you have never done, you've got to be someone you have never been. You've got to be born again. Yes, I would agree to that also. Reinventing yourself is like being reborn. A new avatar of you comes in. You started a new life, and many people have done that, right from some very, very, you know, successful and celebrity people right down to the common sorts of people. Take our Ramaswamy, for example. 35 years in a public sector undertaking, very good cushy position, made a very good name for himself as a design engineer, retired, reinvented himself, and for the last 26 years, he has been doing exemplary work. It's almost like he's a 26-year-old. He's reborn into that new avatar and whatever he's doing. It really amazes me to see how from morning to evening, he's on his feet, helping innumerable patients. Surekha says, reinventing ourselves is making the choice to build a life we don't need to regularly escape from. That's a very, very thoughtful point, Surekha. Many people are looking to escape. People are in jobs and careers which they are fed up of. They just want to get away from it, but they don't know how to do it. They have limitation, they have financial things, they have doubts and this and that. But if you have reinvented and if you've gone into something new, then you will never feel that need to escape from it. You know that you have found something which is pleasurable, joyful, and which gives you contentment. As long as you want, you stay there. Even if you change again further, sometime you do it out of your own free will. Then we have Meena saying, my journey from being a homemaker to becoming a professor has been the best and best journey of my life. It started from Banjara. From being a young, naive, young woman and continuing to be a learner is a celebration in my everyday life. Oh God, didn't know life was unraveling like this. Hearty congratulations, Meena, and continue on this journey. You have a long way to go, and I'm sure with this attitude, you will reach places. Pooja says, hello Ali, firstly, hearty congratulations. I'm in T2 batch. My question is, can you please tell one habit everyone has to cultivate to discover and come out of their cocoon and face the society confidently with happily showing our flaws without worrying it? You have asked a very intriguing question, Pooja. You said, show that one habit. Life never has one answer. Human resources, social sciences do not follow physical laws. If there was that one habit, if there was one answer to anything to do with human behavior, in fact, life would get very boring. There is no one answer. Every one of us has to get out, explore, stumble, fall, get up, and then find the right way. Most inventors have done that. If somebody had told them the way for an invention is do this, go to set up a laboratory, do this, do that, they would never have been inventors, no? Meena says self-discovery can go from strength to strength. Yes, that is what should be our aim. We should never rest on our laurels. We should continuously go from strength to strength, even in different directions. I may have achieved quite a bit in one area, one strength. Again, let me start off with something else. That's how it should go. Okay, Shobha says, your Saturday speech is so helpful and useful, Ali. Thank you for your support. Thanks a lot, Shobha. All these genuine appreciations go a long way in inspiring me and also motivating me. Oh yes, our friend and student Gauri, he is here. Gauri said, I had put off going to Banjara for 15 years in spite of living a stone's throw away. Only after I finally made my way to my second home, I could get a notion of what I am capable of. Life is too short to put things off for later. Glad you have the courage to admit that, Gauri. Not too many people do it. But that shows that you have taken that one step and now nothing will stop you from taking the second and the 10th and the 100th step. It will be a continuous effort and a continuous source of joy to you. Surekha says, does letting go and forgiving ourselves and others play a huge role in the reinventing process? Often it does, Surekha, but it's not necessary. It's not that I have to forgive myself or I have to forgive others. There are areas where there's no forgiveness required. I just want to take up a new path. I want to reinvent. I want to get into something. There are times when, for whatever reason, I may be finding it very difficult to forgive. So it's not an essential thing. I will continue working on that process of forgiving, whether it's myself or others. But I will not wait to move forward and to reinvent and to find new directions to my life. So any of these things should not hold you up. It is like Swami Vivekananda said about a young man who had a very important work and he was going full speed running when he realized that there's a river in front of him, a river where water was flowing very fast. He said, if I jump into the river and try to swim across, I may get swept away. So what I'll do is there's a nice tree here. I will lie down under the tree and wait till all the water passes away. Then I'll walk across the riverbed and continue on my journey. It doesn't happen that way, right? All the water never goes away in life. So that is what we need to understand. Sai Prashant also says, the human mind can take so much pain, but we are unwilling to take the first step to see beyond the pain. Absolutely right, Prashant. And that reminds me of something that I often keep quoting, that is, pain is inevitable. Suffering is optional. Two people are inflicted the same pain, physical or mental. How much person A suffers and how much person B suffers can be very different, because suffering is something that you choose. I am really overwhelmed with the type of comments and questions and ideas that came forward today. Many of them are worth emulating, so I made little notes of that, and I think I will be using them in whatever way I can in order to move on. So with this, I hope you are now become comfortable in this process of the afternoon sessions between 2 and 3. We shall be continuing to do that every Saturday, 2 p.m. to 3 p.m. And as I log out now, Anis will tell you that we will be meeting next Saturday, the same time, that is at 2 o'clock, with the topic, developing self-control. We were talking just now about addictions and habits and all that. Here are some very practical tips that I'll be giving you, and you're also welcome to, you know, add to that before next Saturday. If you give me some inputs, I'll add on to it. How do you develop self-control and also to get out of addictions of all kinds? It could be addiction to people, it could be addiction to habits, it could be addiction to chemical substances. All this comes under what we call as developing self-control. So if you can do that thing of developing self-control, you can really make your life very, very much in your control and make it very much more meaningful. So thanks a lot. Enjoy the weekend, and I shall see you next Saturday, that is 26th of August. Bye-bye.
So for 12 years, I was a housewife, and I decided now it's time to move on. What was that I needed to do? I needed to reinvent myself. So then I asked myself, what is it that I want? What is it that I want to change? In myself, what career am I looking at, or whether I want to be at home? That's when I started jotting out points, understanding. So then I realized that once I decided that I want to change my career path, I decided what I want to do, and I upskilled there. I studied those courses, and today I am doing what I am doing. Now that in turn built positive thoughts and positive emotions and positive actions and habits. Because what happens is, if you do not have positive thoughts and actions or habits, you cannot reinvent yourself. So it takes a lot to keep coming out of your comfort zone and reinventing yourself. And that is what I did by understanding myself and my surroundings.
Reaching out to people and being among the people was one of something which I always wanted and I always looked for. When I selected army as my career, in the initial periods of my service, I really relished, enjoyed being with the people. But as you climb up the ladder, become a senior officer, the touch with the people was reducing. And that's when I made a tough decision of leaving my uniform, which was, of course, I was enjoying, but I had to leave it. And I got into the corporate. The same thing happened here also. As the time passed by, the way I came up the ladder, again, the touch was lost. So though from being a very comfort zone of a very high salary package, it was a very tough decision, but then I said, no, this is not the place where I belong to. And I stepped out and I came to do luckily I came to the way of Vanjara Academy. I did this course and now I'm really enjoying this new life.
So as I grew up, I used to see one LGBT community person near my house. I grew up watching them actually. And I never understood how their life is till I actually came into counseling field from the corporate life. So once I started understanding the community with a lot of counseling, with a lot of reading, with a lot of interactions and things like that, I also reinterred myself, I would say, or in terms of as a human, you know, because I started looking at the human aspects in them as well. So doing a lot of workshops, interacting with them, the community people especially, hearing to their stories, you know, what all struggles they have undergone differently from the so-called, you know, heterosexuals. All these things have added a lot of value to my life. And I would like to say that I'm still reinventing on a regular basis, because the learning is never ending.